This is a community-supported legal education channel. Find out how you can support our mission at the links in the description below.
You might remember that a few months ago, we covered a class action lawsuit brought by Maria Schneider and Pirate Monitor against Google and YouTube and Alphabet. It's supposed to be some kind of class action complaint against them for not handling copyright piracy properly on YouTube. Well, today we have something new. We have a response or an update from YouTube. YouTube has now filed their answer and counterclaims. So that's a big deal. Counterclaims means that YouTube has some kind of claim in the reverse. So the plaintiffs made a claim against YouTube and Google. YouTube and Google have now said not just that we deny your claims, but we have our own lawsuit against you. So this is effectively a lawsuit within a lawsuit. And so YouTube and Google are suing Maria Schneider and Pirate Monitor back. Let's see what they have to say. Since its founding in 2005, YouTube has gone far above and beyond its legal obligations to assist copyright holders in protecting their rights. It has developed best-in-class practices and processes for removing allegedly infringing materials pursuant to the DMCA, which protects online services like YouTube from claims of infringement by their users. It has also invested well over $100 million to pioneer industry-leading copyright management tools like its Content ID system. Precisely because YouTube's novel copyright management tools are so powerful, they must be used with care. These special tools enable users to automatically, or at the touch of a button, remove content from YouTube or block it from appearing in the first place. Misused or put in the wrong hands, these tools can be used to censor videos that others have every right to share through YouTube. These tools can also enable users to wrongfully claim ownership rights in others' content or to take for themselves revenue that rightly belongs to others. Plaintiffs' claims in this case offer an especially pointed example of why YouTube limits access to Content ID. Both Pirate Monitor and Maria Schneider complain that they have not been allowed access to Content ID, but Pirate Monitor has clearly demonstrated why it cannot be trusted to use that tool properly. As set forth in YouTube's counterclaims, Pirate Monitor has engaged in widespread abuse of the DMCA's notice and takedown process, going so far as to upload hundreds of videos to YouTube under false pretenses, only then to turn around and claim through false DMCA notices that those same videos were infringing. This was apparently a ruse to obtain access to Content ID, and when it failed, Pirate Monitor responded with this lawsuit. As for Schneider, she is suing YouTube on copyrighted musical works that she and her agents licensed YouTube to use. Not only that, despite Schneider's claims that she has no access to Content ID, her own agent, in fact, used the tool to generate revenue from those same musical works on her behalf. Use of Content ID requires far greater care and candor. Plaintiff's claims of entitlement to use Content ID are badly misguided, their claims of copyright infringement even more so. So then we get to YouTube's counterclaims. This is the meat of the argument that I wanted to get to. And here's the story. Pirate Monitor has misused the YouTube service and engaged in a fraudulent scheme to obtain access to YouTube's copyright management systems. Pirate Monitor uploaded roughly 2,000 videos to YouTube, each time representing that it had the rights to upload that content and that the content did not infringe on any third-party copyrights. Shortly thereafter, Pirate Monitor invoked the notice and takedown provisions of the DMCA to demand that YouTube remove the very same videos its agents had uploaded. In those notices, Pirate Monitor represented that the videos were infringing its own copyrights or those of copyright owners it claimed to represent. Pirate Monitor's deceptive actions violated the law. It is clear that Pirate Monitor lied to YouTube either when it uploaded the videos in the first place or when it requested their removal. Its misrepresentations were intended to fool YouTube into believing that Pirate Monitor could be trusted not to abuse YouTube's powerful copyright management tools, including Content ID, and its machinations render it liable to YouTube for breach of contract and fraud, or alternatively constitute blatant violations of Section 512F of the DMCA, which relates to misrepresentations. Let's continue. YouTube has invested over $100 million to develop Content ID, a best-in-class content identification system that uses digital fingerprinting technology to help identify copyrighted materials. Using Content ID, rights holders and their agents can be automatically notified of user-uploaded videos that match what they claim are their copyrighted works, and can choose in advance what they want to happen when those videos are detected, including options to monetize the videos or earn advertising revenue when users watch the videos, or they can block the videos from appearing altogether. Content ID and YouTube's other scaled copyright management tools empower users to automatically, or at the touch of a button, remove content from YouTube or block it from appearing in the first place. Thus, the tools have the potential to be used improperly to censor videos that others have every right to post and share through YouTube. Further, the tools enable users to claim ownership rights in others' content and to siphon to themselves revenue that rightly belongs to others. Because of the potential for abuse of these scaled tools, YouTube limits access to them, seeking to ensure that those who use them will do so responsibly and will not cause harm to YouTube, its users, or to other copyright owners. To create an account and post content on the YouTube service, users must affirmatively accept the YouTube Terms of Service Agreement. Under the TOS agreement, in effect during all times relevant to these counterclaims, users uploading content to the YouTube service represented to YouTube that they own or have the necessary licenses, rights, consents, and permission to publish content they submit. Users also granted YouTube a copyright license in and to any content they submit. And users promised that any content they submit to the service would not contain third-party copyrighted material or material that is subject to other third-party proprietary rights unless they had permission from the rightful owner of the material or they were otherwise legally entitled to post the material, and to grant YouTube all of the license rights granted under the TOS agreement. Under the applicable agreement, a user creating a YouTube account promised to provide accurate and complete identification information for the account to YouTube. Under that agreement, a user is responsible for indemnifying YouTube for any claim arising from or relating to their use of the YouTube service. That includes any claim arising from or relating to videos the user uploads to the service. In addition to accepting the terms of the agreement and making the representations and promises it contains, before submitting content to the YouTube service, a user must again confirm the representations and promises in the TOS agreement, and users are again expressly warned against submitting content that violates others' copyrights. During the fall of 2019, Pirate Monitor created a series of accounts on YouTube. Each time it created a new account, Pirate Monitor affirmatively agreed to the TOS agreement. But in order to deceive YouTube, and in violation of the TOS agreement, Pirate Monitor provided bogus account registration information. Rather than properly identifying itself as the account creator, Pirate Monitor used alternative account names to mask the relationship of the account creators and the accounts to Pirate Monitor. Pirate Monitor used these accounts to upload hundreds of videos to the YouTube service during 2019. Included in the videos that Pirate Monitor uploaded in 2019 were clips from the very works that Pirate Monitor now accuses Google and YouTube of infringing in this action, including numerous excerpts from the Hungarian film Zsákcsekszentmihályi. I don't know. I'm learning French. I don't know Hungarian. Through these disguised accounts, Pirate Monitor also uploaded hundreds of excerpts from the Hungarian film Zimmer Fury to YouTube. I'm sure I'm mispronouncing those. I apologize. Each time these videos were uploaded, Pirate Monitor was representing and warranting that the video did not infringe anyone's copyrights, and it expressly granted YouTube a license to display, reproduce, or otherwise use the videos in connection with the service. Pirate Monitor also represented that it owned or had the rights to upload and license the material contained in the videos. Pirate Monitor reconfirmed its representations and promises in the TOS agreement during the upload process for each video. But shortly after uploading these videos, Pirate Monitor sent YouTube hundreds of takedown requests under the DMCA, in many instances for the same videos it had just uploaded through its disguised accounts. In those notices, Pirate Monitor represented that the videos that were the subject of those notices, videos that it had uploaded, infringed its copyrights or the copyrights of a party whom Pirate Monitor was authorized to represent. YouTube processed a substantial volume of DMCA takedown requests and removed the videos. Without the benefit of discovery, it is unclear which of Pirate Monitor's conflicting representations about these videos were accurate. But either way, Pirate Monitor has made misrepresentations on which YouTube relied. On the one hand, if Pirate Monitor falsely represented to YouTube that it had the authority to post the videos and that the videos did not infringe anyone's copyrights, then Pirate Monitor breached the TOS agreement and perpetrated a fraud on YouTube. Had Pirate Monitor not made the representations to YouTube that it did, YouTube would not have allowed it to create accounts on the service, and it would not have allowed Pirate Monitor to upload content to the service. On the other hand, if Pirate Monitor accurately represented to YouTube that it had the authority to post the videos and that the videos did not infringe on any third party's copyrights, then Pirate Monitor made knowingly false statements when it subsequently represented to YouTube in its DMCA takedown requests that those same videos were infringing. Pirate Monitor's serial uploads and takedown requests for the same videos were central to a scheme through which it hoped to gain access to YouTube's powerful copyright management tools, in particular, Content ID. Pirate Monitor had previously applied for and been denied access to use YouTube's advanced copyright management tools. YouTube told Pirate Monitor that access to YouTube's copyright management tools was predicated in part on demonstrating both a need for such access and a history of properly using the DMCA takedown request process. Pirate Monitor believed that it could demonstrate both the need for access and a track record of valid DMCA takedown requests by surreptitiously uploading a substantial volume of content through accounts seemingly unconnected to it, and then sending DMCA takedown requests for that same content. Instead of showing that it could properly use YouTube's tools, Pirate Monitor's deceptive and unlawful tactics established that it could not be trusted and that YouTube was right in rejecting its request for access. So here are the counterclaims, mostly against Pirate Monitor. First, for breach of contract. Pirate Monitor breached the agreement, among other things, by failing to provide complete and accurate information in the account creation process and by uploading videos to YouTube that did infringe third-party copyrights. Pirate Monitor's breaches have proximately caused damage to YouTube, including, among other things, the cost of investigating and processing Pirate Monitor's subsequent claims that the content it uploaded was infringing. To the extent that Pirate Monitor's claims in this action implicate content that Pirate Monitor itself uploaded to the YouTube service, the costs of defending the action as well as any liability also constitute damages proximately caused by Pirate Monitor's breaches of contract. Pirate Monitor is additionally obligated under its agreement with YouTube to indemnify YouTube for claims arising out of or relating to its use of the YouTube service, in seeking defense costs and any potential liability in this action as damages for Pirate Monitor's contract breaches. YouTube expressly preserves its separate entitlement to contractual indemnity and will amend its counterclaims to add a claim for that indemnity if Pirate Monitor refuses to honor its indemnity obligation. Another counterclaim, this time for fraud. In connection with its upload of roughly 2,000 videos to YouTube, mainly from August through November of 2019, Pirate Monitor created more than a dozen YouTube accounts. Each time it created a new account, it promised YouTube in the TOS agreement that any content it uploaded through the account would not infringe third-party copyrights. But Pirate Monitor had no intention of honoring that promise. Rather, it intended to use the newly created accounts to upload material that infringed third-party copyrights. Pirate Monitor repeatedly made this promise in the agreement with the intent of inducing YouTube to allow it to create accounts and use those accounts to post videos and other content to the YouTube service. Had YouTube known Pirate Monitor's true intentions, YouTube would not have allowed the account creation or the post of the content. Pirate Monitor further represented through the agreement and the upload process that it had the authority to post the videos that it did and that the videos did not infringe third-party copyrights. Those representations were false, and Pirate Monitor made those representations knowing that they were false. Pirate Monitor made those representations with the intention of inducing YouTube to accept and allow to be uploaded the content that Pirate Monitor was uploading to the YouTube service. Pirate Monitor made the false representations it did because it knew that YouTube would not accept or allow to be uploaded the content unless Pirate Monitor made those false representations. If Pirate Monitor had not deceived YouTube in these ways, Pirate Monitor could not have sent DMCA takedown requests to YouTube for that content, and could not have established the track record it hoped would gain it access to YouTube's copyright management tools. YouTube reasonably relied on Pirate Monitor's representations regarding the content it uploaded by accepting the content for posting on the YouTube service. YouTube would not have accepted the content but for Pirate Monitor's false representations. Because it hid its intention not to honor its promises in the TOS agreement, and because of the misrepresentations it made in the TOS agreement and against it in the upload process, I think it's a typo, Pirate Monitor was able to upload roughly 2,000 videos to YouTube and soon thereafter sent DMCA takedown requests for those videos. As a proximate result of Pirate Monitor's promises without intention to perform and false representations, YouTube has been damaged in an amount to be proven at trial, but including, among other things, the cost of investigating and processing subsequent claims that the content Pirate Monitor uploaded was infringing. To the extent that Pirate Monitor's claims in this action implicate content that Pirate Monitor itself uploaded to the YouTube service, the cost of defending the action as well as any liability also constitute damages proximately caused by Pirate Monitor's promises without intention to perform and false representations. Pirate Monitor's conduct was undertaken with the intent to injure YouTube and with a willful and conscious disregard of YouTube's rights and constitutes fraud and malice under California law. YouTube is entitled to an award of punitive damages against Pirate Monitor in an amount sufficient to punish Pirate Monitor and deter it from future misconduct. In the alternative, a 17 U.S.C. 512F misrepresentation claim. In its DMCA takedown request, Pirate Monitor represented to YouTube that certain identified videos contained content that infringed its copyrights or the copyrights of a party Pirate Monitor was authorized to represent. Pirate Monitor's representations in those takedown requests regarding infringement were knowingly false. As Pirate Monitor knew well, the videos identified as infringing in its DMCA takedown requests were not infringing its copyrights or those of copyright owners that Pirate Monitor represented. Pirate Monitor knowingly and materially misrepresented that material or activity on YouTube was infringing. YouTube relied upon Pirate Monitor's misrepresentations by removing or disabling access to the material Pirate Monitor falsely claimed to be infringing. But for Pirate Monitor's misrepresentations, YouTube would not have had to incur the costs of processing a multitude of notices and removing roughly 2,000 videos. Further, as a result of Pirate Monitor's material misrepresentations, YouTube had to expend substantial additional sums on an investigation in an effort to detect and thwart such behavior. YouTube was therefore injured by Pirate Monitor's misrepresentations. The sheer number of Pirate Monitor's material misrepresentations in DMCA takedown requests demonstrates that it has little fear of the threat of monetary liability under Section 512F. Further, YouTube has no certain means of identifying future misrepresentations that Pirate Monitor may make, and no ready means of calculating the harm that such misrepresentations would cause to YouTube or its users in terms of lost goodwill, lost audiences, and lost opportunities. To prevent such irreparable harm, injunctive relief barring Pirate Monitor from future misrepresentations in DMCA takedown requests is warranted. Wherefore, YouTube respectfully requests that the court A. award damages against Pirate Monitor sufficient to compensate YouTube for the harm caused by Pirate Monitor's conduct. B. award punitive damages against Pirate Monitor for its fraudulent conduct. C. issue an injunction barring Pirate Monitor and all those in active concert with it from submitting notices of alleged infringement to YouTube that misrepresent that material on the YouTube service is infringing copyrights held or claimed to be held by Pirate Monitor or anyone it claims to represent. D. award YouTube the costs of this action, along with attorney's fees pursuant to 17 U.S.C. 512F against Pirate Monitor, also I think 17 U.S.C. 505. And E. award YouTube such other and further relief as the court may deem just and proper. And that's by David H. Kramer, representative of YouTube and Google. So, wow, that's a lot. So it turns out, at least according to YouTube, that Pirate Monitor was creating the situation that it could then resolve by gaining access to Content ID, and then tried to sue YouTube for both Content ID access and for the copyright infringement that it alleged was created by a situation that it created. I'm sure that there's actual copyright infringement out there, so I'm not sure why they need to go and create alleged copyright infringement by uploading copyrighted videos and then claiming that they have to take them down. So it just seems like they were making a bad problem worse, sort of the Dr. House method of letting the patient get sicker in order to figure out what to do. So here we let the copyright situation get worse, and in letting it get worse, then maybe YouTube will grant us our Content ID access. At least that's the allegation. Let me know what you think in the comments below. We will keep an eye on this one and see what happens next. I'm hoping the parties will not settle so that we get some kind of a ruling and we get a real big smackdown against Pirate Monitor. I also want to congratulate or call out YouTube for not suing Maria Schneider for Pirate Monitor's behavior. Certainly, Maria Schneider is a party to the lawsuit, but the counterclaims seemed to be against Pirate Monitor for their activity, and they didn't seem to go after Maria Schneider as a liable party for Pirate Monitor's activity. Maybe something will change, and maybe Maria Schneider is somehow responsible, but I have my doubts. And so it's nice that if she is not responsible, that YouTube is not going to bring the hammer down on her just for trying to assert her copyright rights. Let me know what you think in the comments. That's our show. Thanks for joining me. I'm Leonard French, your favorite copyright attorney, and this is Lawful Masses, your favorite legal news and education program here on YouTube, also on Floatplane and on Twitch. This is a community-supported legal education channel. Thank you very much to our supporters in the month of September. At the $50 plus level, thank you to Joe Tyson, Wes Delge, Citizen of the Sovereign, John Steele, Gavin Barnard, Evie, Kyle Mudrock, Spirit Bear, Benjamin Hightoff, Steven, Cute Grills in Your Area, Long Reach Jones, Goliath Cleric, Ugly Grill, Shiloh T, Rudolph Bescherer Jr., Oscar the Prophet, Jay Dixon, Hot Grills in Your Area, Ammonite, Engie, Torpedon, Brandon Abel, Cassandra Curran, and I-Anal, I Am Not a Lawyer. And thank you to the $5 plus supporters who are scrolling on the screen in front of me and on the LED panel behind me here. I am Leonard French, your favorite copyright attorney. I will see you in the videos that drop. I hope you have a great week. I love you all. Bye. Wow.